Hello viewers, I'm Mamta. Today we are going to take up the topic of behavioral and developmental disorders. Now, this disorder category basically applies to children and teenagers. Now, behavioral refers to the major changes in behavior while the personality of a child and a teenager is developing and stabilizing. Developmental refers to the developmental age, particularly for childhood and adolescence. This covers, according to Achenbach, two major categories: externalizing disorder and internalizing disorder. Now, since children do not have much of a self-understanding, if they are in trouble, a lot of times they are not able to express themselves, or they are having a discomfort in terms of emotional and psychological well-being, a lot of time they are not able to understand their own self. So with this perspective in mind, this disorder category has come into picture. Externalizing refers to the under-controlled problems. So there's a particular problem which is under controlled. For example, aggression, any disruptive behavior, a behavior which is very, very hurtful outside. So a behavior outside is under control, that is externalizing disorder, under which we have major category of ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and we have ODD, oppositional defiant disorder, which we will cover up in detail. Second major category that we have is internalizing disorders, which are over-controlled, just the opposite of the externalizing disorders. Over-controlled because somebody is extremely sad, depressed, anxious, and this person is not able to express what he or she is feeling. That is why it is over-controlled. Under this, we have the category of autism as a major category. We also have covered under it eating disorders and mental retardation. Let's start with the first category of externalizing disorders. ADHD. Now, ADHD is attention deficit 1, hyperactivity 2, and 3rd is impulsivity. This has 3 categories. Now, a child having ADHD ideally should be diagnosed by 7 years of age, so that if the level is high, medicines can be started. It has, like I said, 3 major categories. Now, it doesn't mean that every child who is having ADHD will have all the 3 categories. It's a combination. A child may have impulsivity, hyperactivity combination, other may have impulsivity and attention deficit, it depends. Let's look at the symptoms of all these 3 categories. Attention deficit refers to inattention. So a child is not able to sustain the mental effort. He is not able to do the task for a very long time. So the focus or the concentration is for a limited duration, and then the child gets bored. So such a child will start off a work and will get bored and leave the activity. Suppose a child starts with tennis playing. He'll do it for some time, 15 days a month, will get bored, shift to another. A child is doing a certain math sum, will again get bored and shift. So that is inattention. A lot of times parents complain that this particular child is not listening to instructions. Now such children normally, it's not deliberate that they're not listening to instructions. It is basically that they are not able to focus their attention on a particular task. So they end up being very, very disorganized. They end up being very, very forgetful, and they are not able to remember things. This is a major problem with attention. Second category that we have is impulsivity. Impulsive, as the word says, is low self-control. So such children will not be able to wait. The patience level is deliberately, it's not that the child doesn't have, it's just that the child is not able to wait for something. So they are not able to delay their satisfaction. Whatever they want it immediately. They cannot wait. So a child standing in the queue will not be having the patience to wait for his turn, will definitely go out of the turn and get whatever is required. Or a child has to speak something, will not wait for his turn. He will speak whenever he can. He will keep on speaking. That is impulsivity. They do not think of the consequence. They just act. They just speak. They just blurt out whatever is on their mind. That is impulsivity. The third category that we have is hyperactivity. Hyperactivity, as the name suggests, the child is in constant motion. It's like there is a lot of motor activity going on. The child is fitted with a motor which is running much faster than the normal person. So it is again not in the hands of the child, because it's a neurological problem where the child cannot sit still. There is so much energy in the child which is not being utilized. And imagine such a child is supposed to sit still for the whole class. It is almost impossible. The child will look around, will be very distracted, would want to pick up something, the child is, he finishes off the work very, very fast, much faster than the other children. So then he would skirm around, he would run around, he would, you know, just do some activity so that he gets a stimulation. That is hyperactivity. Next category of this same category of disorders externalizing is ODD, oppositional defiant disorder. Opposition, that means a child who is opposing the authority, the child who is violating the rules, not following what everybody else is following. It is not just rebellion, it is a genuine problem where the person is extremely stubborn, very, very irritable, and not obeying what is being told for him to follow. The child is more of defiant, so defies the rules and authorities, does not obey, and only behaves in a manner which is antisocial. So here we talk about in ODD category. In fact, if we compare it to ADHD children, in ADHD boys have 4 times much more probability of having ADHD. Whereas when we look at the gender difference in ODD, it is exactly the same, not much difference according to research. So ODD is, if it is there in children and teenagers, it is known as conduct disorder below the age of 18 years of age. And above 18, we call it antisocial personality. So such people, in fact, they can get into a violation of rules as far as societal functioning is concerned. They violate societal norms. They do not follow the family's smooth functioning. They are normally very, very aggressive. And they also get into theft. They get into manipulations. They normally do not feel guilty. So let's say after hitting somebody very badly, they would not really feel guilty that they have hit that particular child. Or they do something very, very destructive, something that is not according to the norms of the society. One particular child, he ended up putting a matchstick in the petrol tank of a bike. So that was very, very destructive again. They don't do it deliberately, just that they have a tendency, because somewhere they've not got the attention, they've not got the love. A lot of inconsistent parenting has resulted in this. And along with this, we call it aggression category majorly. Aggression in the sense it could be verbal aggression when we look at it. Verbal in terms of the hostility comes out in the form of abusing or swearing or any fights that they pick up. And then we have physical, which is actual fights happening. The physical aggression takes place of in terms of the hostility comes out in fighting and physical, hitting somebody. Then we have proactive aggression. Proactive is a kind of a bullying where the child is troubling somebody and having fun at its cost, manipulating things and having fun, which is not really resulting because of any factor. It is proactive. Second category after ODD that we have is internalizing disorders. So in internalizing, like we already know, it's over-controlled categories, over-controlled problems of behavior. And first under this we have is SAD, which is separation anxiety disorder. Now separation anxiety, particularly when children are too much attached to their parent, it could be one parent or both of them, very, very attached. Whenever they have to sit by themselves, whenever they are sitting left alone in a room, they feel very, very insecure. They panic. So imagine such children going to school, what kind of fuss they would create. They would throw so many tantrums because they feel so much anxious when they are separated from their parents, to whom they normally cling on to, and they are very dependent on the particular set of parents. So they're very fearful and they are not able to face and, you know, be in new situations because they are very, very insecure about being left alone. And they normally avoid separation from their parents and they throw a lot of tantrums and fuss for that reason. Second category of internalizing is depression. Now, when we talk about depression, this is basically age-wise, like we say, developmental. So infants, how do they express their depression? Where they are sad, they are passive, they don't respond when the parents are calling out to them. A preschooler would appear very, very withdrawn and inhibited, would not really speak up, will be quiet, and there'll be mutism. The child will not share, will be very sad and upset. Then we have school-age children. How would they express their depression? They'll be very, very argumentative and combative. They will fight back, retaliate, counterattack. Then coming to teenager, they normally get into a lot of guilt and they have these negative thoughts, hopelessness, helplessness. That is how they express their depression. The third category of internalizing we talk about is the PDD category. It is pervasive developmental disorder. Pervasive because it spreads on. In fact, it is there for life. And developmental because it is normally seen in children and teenagers, and then that pattern remains. This is a severe impairment, particularly in social functioning, the social interaction, the communication, expression, eye contact, body language, and a lot of stereotypical behavior. So a child is constantly rocking off and on, and that is a stereotypical movement. We have to cover up autism as a major category under PDD. Now, autism, when we talk about particularly, there's no eye contact in such children. They normally are not very socially responsive to cues. So somebody calling out to them, somebody showing affection to them, they would not respond back. They would just be in their own world doing whatever. Suppose a child is playing with a car, will keep on doing it. Whether mother is coming in or talking to the child, child will be not responsive totally. So there's a big communication problem. Their speech is very, very retarded. They normally keep on repeating the same word. That is a problem. And in fact, such children have very restricted interest. They do not like any kind of change. Whatever they are comfortable with, whether it's clothes, toys, a certain route that they take, they would not really like and be very uncomfortable if there is a certain change in that. So they have a very strong desire for routine. And in fact, they a lot of times stimulate their own self. So a child, let's say, might end up doing a very harmful thing of hitting his head in the wall, but he's liking it because it is giving him stimulation. That is how they get the stimulation. So it is self-stimulatory activities they would end up doing, and it could also be harming themselves. Such children are very fond of music also. A lot of such children are very talented also. It varies from child to child. And 70% of autistic children are also having the category of mental retardation, that is MR. They normally occur together. Next category we have is eating disorders. Now, eating disorders talks about the distorted body image normally occurring in teenagers, where a teenager girl, let's say, feels that, you know, her body image is not appropriate. She will not be overweight, but she feels and perceives herself to be overweight and not having a very good image of herself. So here it would be that, you know, she would end up starving herself. She would not eat. These children normally starve themselves to death, exercise compulsively, do not eat in presence of other people. That is what we call as anorexia nervosa. All these symptoms are the category of anorexia nervosa. Second we have is bulimia nervosa. In bulimia, they end up eating a lot and then they purge it out. So normally when they eat too much, they feel disgusted and ashamed of themselves. Therefore, they purge it out either through medicines, vomiting, through diuretics, or through some kind of, you know, any mechanism where they excrete it out of their body. Third category that we have is binge eating. Now, binge refers to the fact that they eat out of control. Such people normally eat out of control and they feel relieved of their emotions. So it's basically emotional eating and too much of an eating. And again, they end up using purging, and then they are, you know, relieved of their negative emotions. Because now they have felt that I've taken off all the fats which I had already ingested into my body. Let's start with the aspect of mental retardation. Mental retardation, as the term suggests, talks about three major categories. When we look at the definition, it talks about three major aspects to understand what a mentally retarded person actually is. It is actually understood that, you know, a lot of people have this misconception that can a person who is mentally challenged, can it be reverted? Because they normally resort to a lot of medication or a lot of help, whichever kind of help that they can get to understand how mental retardation can be handled. But once the damage has already occurred, once the neurons have already, or the structure has already been damaged, it is impossible to revert it. So normally the IQ level of the child gets affected, or the person gets affected. The person is at a certain age, but his mental functioning or his intelligence is much lower than that particular age. That is where we say that the IQ of a person should be average, at least to behave in an appropriate manner according to society. But for people who are mentally challenged, it is a biological problem. So it's by birth that the person has a low IQ or the damage to the brain structure. So such people normally have three major problems. One is IQ level is below 70. 70 is from 70 we have categories under it, which covers mentally challenged. We have four categories under it, which we'll do in detail. And apart from the IQ, we also have the adaptability. Now such people, because the IQ is low, a person who is not having a mental capacity which is average, the person is having according to the particular age. So suppose if you come across somebody who is of 20 years of age, but actually the person behaves like 12 years person. So the biological age or the physiological age is much higher. The person is growing physically, but when we talk about the mental growth, when you talk about the cognitive development, it is retarded. So that is what we call as mentally challenged. A lot of adaptability problems. They are not able to adjust because if we look at their normal functioning, where IQ helps us, where our intelligence level helps us, we normally do our things ourselves. We call it self-help skills. We dress up on our own, we eat our food, we manage our own daily routine affairs. But people who are mentally challenged normally face a lot of problem in self-help. They also face problem in their academic capacities, where obviously we cannot expect them to study and, you know, complete schooling, because they are not able to manage their daily affairs. So imagine how difficult it would be for them to complete their education and to clear different classes and to move on to higher grades. It gets very difficult because they are anyways facing so many problems in their life, and to expect them on top of it to do academics is going to be very taxing on their capacity. So academics in self-help in adaptive ability. We also talk about their social skills in that in general. When we talk about social skills, we normally say that, you know, they do have expression of their emotion. They do have language that they develop, depending on the category, of course, which we will look at in detail. But they face a lot of problems in terms of adjusting and managing. So that is, again, adaptability capacity. And in this, we talk about whether they marry. This we'll do in detail about the different aspects under it. And last category that we have of the definition talks about below 18 years of age. Now, obviously, a child who is at a lower age mentally will be identifiable much easily. So they are identified below 18 years of age. That's about it for the definition of mental retardation. That's about it for now. Thank you.